All right. Well, welcome to worship. It's time for us to turn our hearts and minds and spirits to the Lord. And if you're out in the lobby, it's time to come on down. This is one of those Sundays where, you know, they say, whenever I visit church, what do they talk about? Money, right? So just warn you ahead of time before we get there. We're also talking about one of the strangest stories the New Testament, where there's a and leave the church in a box. They drop dead. And so if you haven't heard that story before, it'll be interesting. It's Ananias. And we're going there. We're also going to be celebrating communion today. So I'm glad that you're here for that. When we'll come the front, the center aisle, and come to the front, and there'll be bread and wine or juice, and serve yourself and head back the outside aisles. And I'll explain that again there. Well, glad you're here to worship the Lord. Let's worship the Lord today.
Well, good morning. Are you ready to worship today? All right. I cannot see your smiles because of those masks, but that's okay. I know you're smiling.
You call me Lord, you know my name. I'm standing now, I'm not ashamed.
I've searched and came up empty. This world has nothing for me. You are my one and only. I'm living my life for you. I'm giving everything to you.
You're the one who shaped the earth.
'cause you're the one. You have called me out of darkness into your marvelous light. You are the one, Jesus. Jesus, we thank you today that you are the one, the everlasting one. And Father, we give you our hearts and our minds today. And Father, today we are so very grateful that we can reach up to you and you reach down to us. So Lord, today we commit every possible detail of this service into your care. We ask you to minister to our hearts and to our minds as we lift up the name of Jesus. We thank you for that and praise you for it. In Christ's name, amen.
Well, we're glad you're here today. And before you're seated, let's take a minute to greet one another in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. And please be respectful of people's space, however they want to greet, by a handshake or a hand fist bump or whatever, or a hug. Well, so glad you're here. If you can find a seat. I want to announce that we have a birthday girl with us today. Joyce is 90 years young. Yeah. And I think we should sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joyce. Happy birthday to you and many more. And Julie and Twyla brought some birthday cakes. Yes, I think we get our individual birthday cakes. We do. All right. Very good. Well, glad you're all here. We'll have a lot more time to share and fellowship during coffee hour. And the great thing about coffee hour is we gather outside in the lobby and you get to take your masks off if you want. So that's great. Couple of announcements before Carol leads us in prayer. Who has been to Zumba? Do we have any? Yes, all right, yeah. Zumba's a lot of fun, isn't it? And do you have to be really athletic to do Zumba? No, yeah. But it does help. Yeah, all right. By the way, Jenny Yates is doing Zumba here on Tuesday nights, and it's a wonderful time. We have a good time, and some of the neighbors from around the church come, and it's just wonderful, and you do it in your own way at your own speed. And I encourage you to attend if you haven't. We've got a Zoom Bible study going on in the book of Acts. So if you're getting into the book of Acts in what we're doing on Sunday morning and want to get in a little bit deeper, you can come to our Zoom Bible study. We just got started last week, so there's still time to catch up and get involved. And if you email me, I'll send you a link. Saturday, September 25th, we're going to have an all-church work day. And so we're going to be doing some cleaning, we're going to be washing some windows, and we're going to do some painting, and we've got some stuff to do in the sanctuary yet, and OLAR, the Hispanic Fellowship that meets here Sunday evenings, they are going to come help again too, which is great. And last time they brought lunch, and I'll tell you, it was really good. When I bring lunch, it's Burger King, but when they bring lunch, it's empanadas and all kinds of good stuff. So I don't know who's bringing lunch this time, but we have a great time of fellowship, and it's good to get to know the other folks that use our building for worship. We had a prayer meeting last week, and it was good and well attended, and we got some praying done. We're going to be praying again on Monday this time, September 27th, and we'll meet here in the sanctuary. I see Kathy Belden is around somewhere. Oh, right over there. If you want to order script, see Kathy Belden, and she can help you with that. And then we're not passing the offering plate, as many of you know, because of COVID. There is an offering plate in the back by the sound booth, or you can always mail in your offerings to the church or have it sent by your bank, or we have Tithely. That's an app you can get that works really well that you can get from our website. Anything I'm forgetting in announcements? I think that's it. All right, Carol, would you come lead us in prayer?
So good to be with you here today. This is the first week I've been using our new technology of an iPad to move the slides forward. And I was realizing, you know, usually I have to have somebody to push the buttons for the Lord's Prayer. And I was coming up here, I thought, I can push the buttons. You don't have to wait for somebody in the back. So you guys have the words up there if you haven't learned them by heart by now. So that was kind of fun to discover that right in the middle of everything else. So it's pretty cool. Technology is great. It can be worked used to our advantages in so many wonderful ways. We see it abused at times, of course, but there's also some great advantages. So here I feel like I'm advanced again. So we have a lot of prayer requests here that have come in over the week, so I'll be going through those. A lot going on in our country, natural disasters. It's like, how many more can we add to our list? And I know that's on all of our hearts and minds, and we may have family or friends in those areas affected as well. So those are the things that I'll be praying for, among other things. So let's go ahead and pray. Dear God, thank you for our time today here at Hope Community Church. Thank you, God, so much that we can be here in the building together, worshiping you, raising our voices in song and worship to you with each other in community. It's such a treat after not getting to do that for so long. So thank you. And also for those who are able to join us through Facebook Live, where they can also be singing along with us and being here, experiencing the worship as well. Lord, we want to be praying for many people and the difficulties and sadness in their lives, in addition to the wonderful things that do happen as well that we can attribute to you. Lord, we want to pray for Ina and Ina's friend, Vanjie, and her family. Vanjie passed away this last Sunday with COVID after her husband had passed away. Hector passed away about 2 weeks ago from it as well. So please be with Ina and with Vanjie's family, Ina's longtime friend for her, and it's just very hard. Also, Lord, we want to thank you for Jim Olson's surgery last Monday. That went well. He's in the hospital. He will be going home today. And so we just want to praise you for that and continue to be with him as he recovers and with his family as he heals from that surgery and he gets back to normal. Lord, we also want to pray for Frank Fitzpatrick's family. He passed away this last Tuesday. So we want to pray for his family, for Susie and her loss at this time and the families as well. Lord, we also have another loss. Harry Yates, who is Jenny and Chris Yates' grandfather, he passed away this last Friday. So we want to pray for his family, for Jenny and for Chris and all of them for that loss. Lord, we also want to pray for Sherry Anderson's friend, Mike. His son, who's 23 years old, he passed away from COVID this last week. He leaves behind a fiance and a six-month-old son. So, Lord, we just want to be in that situation and praying for that family, the young family of this very difficult loss. And, Lord, we've been seeing so many of these disasters in our country. We have fires in California and different places around the world. Please be with those people who are displaced, who are worried about their homes or who've lost their homes. Just bring resources and comfort to those people. Bring help us to know when we need to step in and help as well. So, Lord, please be with folks, and also for the poor air quality and what that does to people's health, and help them find relief. Lord, we also are praying for those who are in the flooded and storm-damaged areas, for the families who've had individuals who died in those floods, and also those who are without electricity. Please bring, again, relief to those areas and resources and help as they work through those very difficult situations. And also, Lord, in Afghanistan and the tremendous unrest there, Lord, for those who are trapped, who can't get out, and the concerns about what's going to happen to those people in that world. We know that's those situations where you act, where you rise and come to those people in the hardest times in their lives, and we just pray that you will be there for those people, for relief in their souls and their hearts. Lord, we want to pray for Ken Brown's friend, Maya, who lost her son, Brock. Pray for that family and the loss. Also, Lord, we want to say thank you and praise you for Pastor Steve's nephew, who was able to move back to his home in Pollock Pines. His home was in the fire area, and he was able to move back. And also, Lord, I want to thank you for my son, Nicholas, who arrived back home in North Carolina after a cross-country drive, and he's safe. So thank you for that. Lord, there's so much on our hearts and so much going on in our individual lives. You know all of them, and we can turn to you, and you know what's happening in the next moments of our lives, and we can be comforted that you know that, and that you were right there with us, and that we could depend on you in the hardest times. We also know that we can look for how you work and the miracles that you bring into our lives, and that we can rejoice and be happy in that. Now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Have a good week.
All right, but I would like the slides up for the sermon, if that's possible. Hopefully that'll happen soon, but we can get started. We're in the book of Acts, and where we are in the book of Acts today, it's where Luke describes the early church for the second time. So this is the second description of the early church. And before we jump into that, I want you to think for a moment. How would you describe our church? Or if you're visiting today from another church, how would you describe the church that you go to? How would you describe your church? If you were at the store or walking around, you know, walking your dog or whatever, and somebody said, hey, I'm looking for a church, tell me about your church, what would you tell them? How would you describe it? And while they're getting our technology going again, just turn to somebody and tell them how you would describe your church, if somebody asked you. Just take a minute and do that. You might say, we're the church where the iPad didn't work. That's what. So if Luke were to ask me to describe my church, I'd pull out one of our little cards, right? Remember these? I love my church. And I might respond like this. I might say something like, well, it's at 2190 Peralta Boulevard. It used to be an old medical building, but it's been remodeled, and but it doesn't really look like a church. It won't look like a church, but on Peralta, we've got this great sign. It's really visible, and it lights up. We have a new logo, and but you can't see the church from the road. You've got to go down the little driveway, and so when you see the sign, you pull in, and you'll be in the parking lot, and you'll see, and that's our church, and there's some new signs on the doors. We're really happy about that. And if you go inside, oh, we're so excited. We've got some new carpeting, and we've spruced up the sanctuary. And if I described our church like that, I think Luke would look at me a little puzzled. And Luke would say something like, well, I'm glad you love your church, but could you tell me one thing about your church? You haven't told me anything about your church. And I'd say, what? I just described my church. So what's Luke's disconnect? Why doesn't Luke get it? Help me out here. Well, I haven't mentioned the Lord. Right. I haven't talked about the Lord, and I've talked all about the building, and the church is not a building. It would not even occur to Luke to describe a building, or even for a church to own a building. And in our passage today, Luke uses the word church for the first time in the book of Acts. And the word church itself has nothing to do with a building. It has everything to do with a community of people. Oh, we got it going. All right. All right, guys. Thanks. The word in Greek in the New Testament for church is ecclesia. And it means those who are called from or those who are called to. Isn't that interesting? Those who are called from or those who are called to. And the common usage of ecclesia back in the day was that it meant an assembly or a gathering of people for a specific purpose. It wasn't even a religious word when Luke started using it and the other Christians started using it. You could think of it as they're talking about the gathering or the community or the people getting together. That's what it meant. And in New Testament usage, as the Bible writers came to use the word and the Christians made it part of their vocabulary in the early church, it came to mean the new community of faith that joined together, called out, called from the world to follow Jesus together. So if Luke asked me to describe the church and I said something like, we are a community of hope, sharing our hope in our Lord Jesus Christ with our community, and Julie is there, and Kathy is there, and Raymond is there, and Earl is there. Not today. Where's Earl? Earl. He's online. Okay. Hi, Earl and Yvonne. He is here. And we often meet at 2190 Peralta Boulevard. Luke would get it, right? Luke would get it. So let's listen to how Luke describes the early church in the book of Acts. We're in Acts 4, chapter 4, verse 32. All the believers were in one heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. Wow. A lot of sharing, a lot of caring, teaching, miracles, prayers. Remember what we've talked about. There were a lot of folks there from out of town. They'd come for Passover, and then they came back for the festival of Pentecost. And now, after Peter preached, and they had this experience of coming to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and being filled with the Holy Spirit, they wanted to stay in Jerusalem. They didn't want to miss anything that God was doing. And so there was a real practicality to people who lived in Jerusalem to sell some property, to open up their homes, to share their food. Makes sense, doesn't it? They wanted to stay there where it was happening. You know, I remember back in high school, I can actually remember back that far, and that's when I really came to know Jesus, was in high school. And there was a couple in our town, Karen and Jack Swanson, and they had a huge house on this lake, and they had found Christ, and they had opened up their house for people who wanted to know Jesus. And they had what we called the meeting. So it's like the gathering, the ecclesia. We had meetings at their house, and there were prayer meetings and Bible studies and worship time. And when I first came to Christ, it was like I just couldn't get to enough meetings, you know, enough getting together with my brothers and sisters. We even had a Bible study during lunch hour at high school. Amazing. And the Swansons, they organized things to where the big meeting was, they had two of them. One was on Friday night for the teenagers, and one was on Saturday night for the adults. Well, guess what happened? The adults weren't getting enough on Saturday night, so they started coming on a Friday night too. And us teenagers, we just couldn't get enough, so we came on Friday and Saturday night. So they stopped splitting us up. We could just come. And everybody was there. They had to build a room onto their house to get everybody in. And we would go to their house and hang out even when the meeting wasn't going on, because we wanted to be where it was happening. If there was an answer to prayer or some miracle or some word from God, we wanted to be there. And that was great, but I want to tell you something. It wasn't God's plan for us to sit around all day at the Swanson's house, waiting for cool stuff to happen. It was God's plan for us to get out, to move on, to graduate high school, actually to pay attention to our studies once in a while, and then to take his good news out into the world. And we're going to see that in the book of Acts. Everybody would have loved to just stay in Jerusalem, because it was happening in Jerusalem. And though they stayed there for a while, Jesus' plan was to get them going to Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth, back to their hometowns, into the whole world. And in the next few chapters, we're going to see that happen. In spite of themselves, they had to get out of Jerusalem. And if circumstances hadn't changed, I kind of wonder if Christianity would have spread much farther than Jerusalem. Maybe they'd still be sitting in Jerusalem today. Maybe that's where we'd think we had to go. But Christianity isn't like that. Well, we're going to really get into that more as we get into the book of Acts. You know, but I think in our day and age, one of the consequences of the pandemic, and there's been a lot awful about the pandemic, and we just heard about that in our prayers today. I don't know of a prayer time when we talked about so many people passing away. Did anybody else pick up on that? Yeah. Oh, pandemic's been horrible, but I think one of the good things of the pandemic is that the church was finally forced to leave the building. Now, what are you talking about, Pastor? We couldn't come to church. Well, for a long time, God has been wanting his people to finally get the idea that following him is about a whole lot more than a holy huddle at 9:30 on Sunday mornings. You know, gathering in God's name on Sunday, that is part of it. And I hope you come. You know, come to church. You know, and it's good to be back in the church, but building. But and there is a time when God is here in the house with us in this building. But we can't confuse it. We can never forget that God's house is not a building. We are the living temple of the living God. When Acts was being written, it was all about the temple in Jerusalem. And people thought that's where you had to go to meet with God. You had to go to the temple. But the message in the book of Acts and in the Gospels is that God has left the building. Oh, he's still in the temple. But the temple's not a building. The temple's not a building made of stones with human hands. The temple of God is people. God's people, living stones, joined into a temple of the living God by the Holy Spirit. And being part of the living temple of God, being the temple of God, being the family of God, being the gathering of God, means we're going to have to do a lot of caring and sharing together as a family. And that's what Luke is describing in this passage. He's describing some caring and sharing and being family and being the temple of God together. What's interesting is Luke actually quotes the Old Testament in this passage. And it may not jump out to us, because we don't really live in the Old Testament that much. We seem to live more in the New Testament, don't we? But there's lots of good stuff in the Old Testament. And these people, when Acts was being written, they were just full of Old Testament imagery. And when Luke says there was not a needy person among them, that's right out of Deuteronomy chapter 15, where it talks about the year of Jubilee. Have you heard of the year of Jubilee? It's when all the debts are paid off. I think we should practice this in our culture. But all the debts are paid off, all the slaves are set free, all the indentured bond servants are let go. The scripture prophesies that when the Messiah comes, it'll be like the year of Jubilee. So when Luke says there is not a needy person among them, he's saying, hey, the Messiah is here. We are living in the time of Jubilee. And it's also a picture of what we call in our 10 marks of a healthy missional church. You remember those? We haven't talked about those for a while, but one of them is sacrificial living and giving. This is a picture of Jubilee and freedom in the Lord and sharing and caring, but it's also a picture of sacrificial living and giving. So it's sacrificial living and giving is not simply sharing our excess. Now, it's easy to share your extra, right? But sacrificial living and giving is choosing to go with less so that others might have enough. And that's an important concept as we go further in the scripture today. So let me say that again. Sacrificial living and giving, it's not simply sharing your excess, sharing your extra, but it's choosing to go with less that others might have enough. And Luke wants us to understand what that is and what that is not. So we're going to see two examples of this. One that shows sacrificial living and giving, and one that shows something that is not sacrificial living and giving. And I think it's important for us, because a lot of our giving today, and I'll just say, I'll confess, a lot of my giving today in my life is based on my excess. Isn't that the way with most of us? Can I afford to give this? Can I give this away without it crimping my lifestyle? But what about a time when we realize there's something we can't afford not to share? You see the difference? What can I afford to share? But what can't I afford not to share? So if this is not making sense, what I'm talking about, I think as we get into the scripture and we hear Luke's examples, it'll start to make sense. So verse 36. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. Now, Barnabas, we're going to learn a lot about Barnabas in the rest of Acts, so I'm not going to say a ton about Barnabas today, but just to say that Barnabas, he was true to his nickname. He was an encourager, and he was there for the glory of God. He was there for the glory of God and the good of the church. And this gift that people talk about, that Luke talks about that he gave, it was not about Barnabas. It was not to draw attention to Barnabas, to what a good guy he was, which he was a good guy. But this gift was to draw attention to what a good God we have. And the more we see of Barnabas, and we're going to see him several times before we're done in the book of Acts, every time we see him, it's like, yeah, he is an encourager. He is someone who lifts others up. And if I had to describe Barnabas in just a few words, I would say Barnabas was a man who was all in. Have you heard that expression before, all in? Where does that come from? Poker, yes. Was that Dave? Ron taught you that. So do you know what poker game that's from specifically, where they really do? Texas Hold'em. That's right. So what does it mean if you go all in? Help me out with that. Right. You put everything you have into the pot. So if you put everything you have into the pot, you go all in, that must mean you have the best hand at the table, right? Does it mean that? Or you're bluffing. Right. It can mean one of two things. If you go all in, and Ron taught you bluffing. Okay. Well, it's good to be in a worship team together so you can teach each other these things, right? Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes you have a good hand that you believe in, and you think that, yeah, I could beat anybody at this table, because you've been counting the cards, right, Dave? Is that no? So you think you can beat anybody at the table, so you go all in. You go all in because you know you're going to win. Other times you go all in because you're just bluffing. And who knows if you're bluffing or not? Hopefully you know. But I'll tell you, someone who knows every time you're bluffing, God always knows who's bluffing when they go all in. Well, Barnabas was all in. He wasn't bluffing. He put it all on the line for the glory of God, the good of the church. The Spirit moved in Barnabas's heart, mind, and soul, and so he sold a piece of land. He donated all the money from the sale to the God's work in Jerusalem, and there was no bluffing, and there was no embellishing. There was just some sacrificial living and giving. There was another man who was impressed by Barnabas' example, and he thought, whoa, cool. I'd like to do something like that. But the problem with this guy, he wanted to look like Barnabas and have people look at him like they looked at Barnabas, but he wasn't all in. It wasn't about God's glory. It was about his glory, about his reputation. Verse 5 is where we meet him. Now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, and he brought the rest to the apostles' feet. And here's where it gets interesting. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you've lied to the Holy Spirit and you've kept for yourself some of the money you received from the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God. Wow. Do you see what Ananias was up to, along with Sapphira? They wanted to look like they were going in, all in, but it was really a bluff. Presented like it was sacrificial living and giving, but in reality, it wasn't. He was just giving the excess. He was giving the extra. He was giving what he could afford. He was not choosing to go with less so others could have enough. He was choosing to give of his excess. And before we go too much further, let me clarify something, and you can help me with this. So what was Ananias' sin? Lying. It wasn't about that he gave from his excess only, so we've got to be clear on this. That wasn't the sin, was it? It was lying. That was lying about it. It was about, well, I'll say it nicely, it was about bluffing. That really was lying, wasn't it? And we won't talk about what goes on in poker games. All right. But who was he lying to? Help me with that. Who was Ananias lying to? Yeah, Holy Spirit, God, and everyone. His brothers and sisters in Christ. He was lying, he was bluffing, he was not all in. He made it look like he was all in, but he really wasn't. You know, so either he believes in God or he doesn't believe in God, or he believes he can fool God. But he couldn't fool God, could he? Either way, whether he was fooling himself or thinking he could fool God, he wasn't all in because he didn't believe that God was the be-all, end-all, God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, who knows what you're thinking even before you think it. You know, you can fool people around you, and you might even fool yourself, but you are not going to fool God. Being all in, as much as God loves to see sacrificial living and giving in our lives, It's not about the amount. It's not if you give 10% or 20% or 120%. It's about really knowing in your heart of hearts that it's all God's. And being there and willing to give when God says give. Because who does it belong to anyway? It belongs to Him. And we just get to take care of it, manage it, use it for His glory. You know, Jesus talked about a widow who put two coins in the offering plate one day at the temple. Do you remember that story? And He said that woman who put in two coins gave more than the guys who went up there and put in $1,000 and bragged about it and said, look at me, I'm putting in $1,000, because they gave of their excess, made it sounded like they were sacrificing, but they weren't. She gave out of her need, and she gave more. You know, I was so impressed with our church. This comes up later, but I'll just say it now. I'm impressed with you guys. We have just done a wonderful job of giving throughout COVID. Through 2020 and 2021, we have met all our expenses as a church. We've been able to remodel things, put in a new carpet, new furnace, air conditioner, do some painting, get some, our soundboard went unexpectedly. We got a new soundboard. And, you know, God even knew what we needed before we needed it. We thought we needed one iPad. We ended up needing two, and two showed up. It just very cool. We just have to learn how to use them, and then we'll be fine. And many people took their COVID relief check and gave it to the church. And I did that. But I'll tell you, when I did that, that was out of my excess. Because the church has faithfully paid my salary all through COVID. I didn't need any relief check. So glad God could use it. Huh? But it didn't hurt me. It was no sacrifice for me. I mean, I was real careful I didn't look at it too long, you know, because I had some things I'd like to do with that, like guitars. But I didn't need a new guitar, really. Well, I think I do, but you know what I'm saying? It was not a sacrifice in any way, shape, or form. It was out of my excess. For others, and I know there's others who gave their relief checks or part of their relief, and I don't know what anybody gives. I just want to let you know that in what I'm saying. I have no idea who gives what, but I do know, in a sense, that some people gave out of their need when they gave part of their relief check, or even all of their relief check. It was not out of their excess. It was generous, sacrificial living and giving. Both are good. We just need to be honest, right, about what we're doing. In a lot of ways, this passage is not about giving, even though I'm talking about giving. It's about being honest about our relationship with God, is what it's all about. But Shannon and I went to a, as long as I'm talking about money, I'm going to talk a little bit more about money today. So you get to be here on the Sunday the pastor talked about money. But I want to be clear, in some ways I don't need to, because you guys are doing good. But I think it's important to really cement this in our hearts and minds. So we were at a fundraising dinner. And it's for a clinic, Christian clinic in San Jose, called the Healing Grove. And they help poor people get medical care. And you can just walk in the clinic and get medical care. And they showed these slides, and I want to show one of them. And it might be hard to read, but this is giving by age and religion in the Bay Area. The San Francisco Bay Area, our whole Bay Area. The white bar, that's people under the age of 40. And the top thing, that's Christians. And the other bar, the beige bar, that's people over the age of 40. And the top is active Christians. And so active Christians, I'll just pick on the ones over the age of 40, they give close to 5% of their income to the Lord's work, or to benevolence type things. Close to 5%. People who are not Christians don't do quite as well. 1%. I thought that was pretty amazing. So praise God for His people that are sharing. But what if And this is what they told us, and I was just amazed by this. And I'm not going to pick on the people under 40. they're down on the other side, but they will grow up, right? Praise God. And that's why we're talking about this today. They said, what if all the active Christians in the Bay Area, just the Christians, active Christians, gave another 5%? What if they actually gave 10%? What would happen? I was blown away. Now, you got to remember, there's high incomes in the Bay Area. You know, there's, you know, millionaires and multimillionaires. So, and a lot of them are Christians. But this is what they said. They said, we could generate $6 billion a year for poverty alleviation if active Christians just gave 10% of their income. Isn't that amazing? The next slide is actually even more amazing when they talked about what could happen if active Christians gave 10%. They said we could build housing for all the 28,200 homeless people. I think that's the number of homeless people in the Bay Area. We could build housing for them in 3 years. We could provide a supportive wraparound service for all homeless. And their group is called Healing Grove. They supply health care for up to 339,000 people every year that don't have any health insurance. They said we could provide that health care for them. We could provide 50,000 addicts 1 year of rehab. We could start 1,000 churches with $1 million each. We could build 40,000 wells in impoverished countries. And then the clicker at the end. And do this year after year after year after year. Isn't that startling? My goodness. Now, this is my guess, and I know it's on a scale, but I'm just going to guess that most all of us could give 5% and have it be excess. Not everybody, but I'm sure probably the majority of us, we have 5% excess income that we can give to God's work. If we get to 10%, that might be cutting in for some. But I have a feeling there might even be some among us that 10% is excess income. Or maybe you've been tithing for years, and that's just your lifestyle now, and you've been able to be comfortable there. So in a sense, maybe it's still excess. But I think, do you get the picture? And so just an aside, and I think maybe you're clicking on this already, Healing Grove says if this happened, you know, they could provide health care to 339,000 uninsured people. I was thinking about the Maasai Clinic. You know, we just talked last week, didn't we, or the week before, I think, about how the funding has come through to start building the Maasai Clinic. It's going to be an 11-room clinic. When they first get started, a nurse practitioner, but then they'll have a full-time doctor. Eventually, they'll have a pharmacy there. And what I found out is when they first get going, it's going to cost a whopping $1,000 a month to operate that clinic. Do you think God might be speaking to some of us about moving above giving of the excess and maybe doing some sacrificial living and giving, and we could actually support that out of our little church? I wonder if that could happen. Just saying. But the point of the message and the point of Luke's story, it's not about the money. It's about, are you all in? Because you know you're backing a winner, Jesus Christ. And he is the be-all, end-all. And you're all in with Jesus. Or do you just like looking like you're all in? It's about being honest about where you are in your walk with God. It's about bringing glory to God and not yourself. And that's why I don't know what anybody gives in the church. It's none of my business. Only a few deacons know. It's about bringing glory to God, right? Glory are not to ourselves. So back to Ananias. And what happens next? When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. Wow. And great fear seized all who heard what was happening. Some young men came forward, wrapped up his body, and carried him out and buried him. 3 hours later, his wife came in. She was late to worship that day. Peter asked her, "Tell me, what's the price you paid? You and Ananias got for the land." Yeah, what is the price you and Ananias got for the land? She said, "Yes, that is the price." And then Peter told her, "How could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? Listen, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door. They will carry you out also." And at that moment, she fell down at his feet and died. And the young men came in, finding her dead, carried her out, buried her beside her husband. And great fear seized the whole church who heard about these events. Wow. I think, wouldn't great fear seize you too? And, you know, praise God, we don't hear about this happening again in the book of Acts. We're going to hear some pretty crazy, intense stuff about people who try to fake being Christians or try to misuse or abuse the gifts of God. There are some other things happening, but not to this degree. And let me say, I don't believe, I mean, it could happen. I don't think God's going to strike you dead if you're bluffing about your faith and your relationship with God. But bluffing about your faith and bluffing about your relationship with God will bring death into your spiritual life. You understand what I'm saying? We can't be set free from the things that trap us and bind us unless we confess them and seek God's healing and forgiveness. The way it works is we say, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." And if we pretend we're not sinners, each and every one of us, who are we fooling? We're not fooling God. You might fool that person next to you, but not for very long. You're only fooling yourself. If we can't be honest with God, if we can't be honest with our brothers and sisters about our warts and all, we're not going to find the healing and forgiveness and new life that God wants us to experience. Does that make sense? Is that hard or easy? Hard. We live in a culture where we all want to what? Look good, right? But we're not going to be getting good unless we admit where we are and confess that and allow God to have his way with us. And that's what they're talking about in the next verses. And we're going to close. I'm just going to read these verses, and then we'll go to the table, communion table. "The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared join them, even though they were highly regarded people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. And as a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats, so at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns and around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed. Then the high priest and all his associates who were members of the party of the Sadducees were filled with jealousy." Wow. So you think folks would have stayed away from these Christians if they heard people were dropping dead. And some of them were a little bit afraid to gather with them. But people started coming to Jesus, kept coming to Jesus like crazy. More and more came to faith, I think, because they saw these people were really all in. That this wasn't a bluff. This was the real deal. And that was because, not because they put on a good show, but because they were themselves. Does that make sense? And I think that's what the world wants to see. The world is waiting to see us. Are we all in, warts and all? Or are we just putting on a show? We are the light. Jesus shines through us, shines his light through us. We are the salt of the earth. Our witness in life is to make people thirsty for Jesus. And when we come to the table, and we're going to go to the table now, it's a sign that we are all in. Not that we're perfect, but that we're forgiven. And we serve a good God. And when we come to the table, we rededicate ourselves to the Lord every time. And say, "Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for the times I've been bluffing. Come in. I want to go all in. Let me be all in." That's what we're doing every time we come to the table. It's time to renew our faith. It's a time to renew our commitment to each other as brothers and sisters in Christ. So let's pray as we come to the Lord's table. Worship team, you guys can come on up. Well, Lord, we thank you for this supper shared in the Spirit. And I ask that as we eat this bread and drink this cup, as we take these elements into ourselves, that it would be a reminder that we are all in. We are in you, you are in us, and we are the family of God together. We are the church together. We are the family of the living God, and we are your light and your witnesses in the earth. So help us, Lord, to know that, to live in that, and to be all in with you today. In Jesus' name, amen. So our Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body given for you, the body of Christ given for us." And then in the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed with my blood. All of you, drink of it, the cup of the new covenant." And every time we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we celebrate the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. And he will come again. And I'll just tell you, the way this world is going right now, isn't that good news? The Lord is coming again. And he is here right now by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that is good news, too. So as the guys play, I invite you to sing and worship and to come to the table. And everything's arranged so we can be physically safe from germs. And was prepared with gloves, so you're all good. You're all okay. And so if you'd like to partake of the Lord's Supper, just come down the center aisle and take a cup and take a piece of bread, and you can head back to your seats. All right? Let's praise the Lord.
as he glorifies you in the power of your Spirit. We have come to something so mysterious, too deep for minds to comprehend. Through the open door where the angels sing and the host of heaven are anthemizing, we'll sing the glory of your name, celebrate the glories of your grace. We will worship you. We will worship you. We'll make your praise so glorious, singing songs of everlasting praise. We will worship you. We will worship you. Oh Lord, we will worship you. You are high. Commands the morning, even oceans.
You know, something hit me while we were singing. I was just thinking, what would have happened if when Peter said to Ananias, you know, asked him about the land, if Ananias said, you know, I'm sorry, I lied. What do you think would have happened? There would have been a party. I want you to think about that. There would have been a party. They would have said, yes, you did, and we're so glad you admitted it. Now let's ask God for forgiveness and let's get on with it. Now I just want to share that with you and with me. Because we all got stuff, don't we? We all got stuff we're not honest about. And what would happen if we just said to God, hey, God, I'm not honest about that. This idea about being all in, I'm not sure if I'm really all in. I'd like to be all in. Would you like to be all in? You can get all in any day you want, right? You can get in today. There's no expiration date. You can get in. So I just want to encourage you. If you want to be like a Barnabas, we'll figure out. You want to be a Barnabas? You want to be Ananias? I think I'd like to be a Barnabas, wouldn't you? You can be a Barnabas. Each and every one of us can. I want to invite you to get all in with Jesus. Because you know what? Jesus is already all in with you. That's what that thing up there is all about. He went all in with us, so we might be all in with him and all in with each other. So let's get all in. Let's go in all in. Lord Jesus, as we leave this place, we don't leave you. Because you're with us, because we are your church, wherever we might be, whether we're online or whether we're in the building or whether we're halfway around the world, we are your church together. Help us to know that. And Lord, we know we've got a lot of problems. We know we're messed up in many ways, but you are not. And you're all in with us. Help us to be all in with you. In Jesus' name, amen.